Let's get started right away. So we are going to create the blog project as described in the section creating your first project in the documentation. To get started, we use the IHP new command to generate the new blog project. Just takes a couple of seconds to generate all the files. And we can see the files have been generated over here. We can use the start script to start the built-in development server. This built-in development server actually also starts a Postgres server, so you don't have to manage that in your development environment for yourself. Over here, we can see the development tooling has been started already. At the left, we can see all the different tools we can use. This right now is the Schema Designer. There's a database exploration tool, REPL, CodeGen, logs, minting, and everything else. And yeah, at the top, we can actually click this one to open our application. So this is a start page. It's working. So that's already pretty good. And yeah, we want to build a blog page. We want to build a blog. So for that, we need to first define our data structures. We are going to have a post table with a title and a body. So we can use the Schema Designer over here to create this table. We can click Add Table, enter the table name posts. We can see that the ID field has been auto-generated over here. And that's pretty nice. We can now click Add Column to add our title column, which is of course a text field. And we can just click Create Column. We do the same for the body field. It's also just a text field and has no special options over here. Nice. Now we have already defined our data structure. At the top, we can see that this is basically just the schema scroll file in the application folder. So let's quickly take a look at that file. And here we can see that the schema scroll is basically just a list of create table statements. And when we make changes to this file, like this, we can, when we reload the page, see that it's basically just editing the same thing. So when we now delete this column over here, it's also gone over in the text editor because it's actually just a editor on top of the text file over here. We can also use the toggle over here to switch to the code editor mode when we want to do that from the browser. So now we can use this to basically generate a first controller. We just right-click the post table, click on Generate Controller, and as you can see, this switches to the CodeGen module over here. And here we can already see a preview of all the files being generated. It's like the controller itself and some changes to other files and the views. And we can just click generate and the controller has been generated. Now we can go back to the schema and right-click on our post table and click on open controller to actually open the controller. And now we get an error message that the database is outdated because of course the table is still missing in the database. We just edited the create. Basically, we just created the file with the migration in it, right? And now we have to apply this migration basically. We use the updateDB button to actually apply our create table statement over here. So we click that button. And we can see the database has been updated successfully. Now we can just go back and reload the page. And we can see all our post controllers is available now. We can actually use the new button over here to create a first post and click create post and it's there already, which is pretty cool. You can also use the edit to edit this thing here and you can go to the show view to display it. And so this is basically already a working controller. We just have to make modifications to make sure that it works as expected, right? So let's go to the show view and make it a bit more beautiful. So we can open the show view over here. It's basically in the inside the web application folder under below view posts, the show file here. And let's make some changes to basically change the headline to the title of the of our post. At the left, we can see it's actually live reloading as we make changes over here. Now we add the body of our post to display it over here. And you can see it's working out of the box. Basically, we don't have to do any hard reloads. It just reloads automatically. Now let's change this over here, the index view. This looks a bit ugly, so let's make it display the title of the post. Just change it over here, and it has changed already. So that's already pretty nice. But right now, when we click create post, we can basically create empty posts and everything. So let's add some validation to that. For that, we are going to open the post controller over here, and we are going to add inside this build post function, we are going to add a validate field title non empty. And now when we click create post, it basically tells us this field cannot be empty. So we can fill something in there. Let's also make the body non-empty as well. So now when we click create post, we get the same error message here. So we can just add some content over here and then create post, and it's already here. So the validation also automatically works when we use the edit function. So basically, we can just edit here and then it works everywhere, basically. So that's already pretty nice. In the next step, we are going to add a timestamp to our post because right now we don't really know. You can see, like right now, the second post is first, but maybe want to, but you can't really see which post was created when. So let's create a timestamp field to our post. We go back to the schema editor, to the schema designer, and we make right click at column, and we type in created at, which will automatically select a timestamp with the default value now. We click on create column to create this column. We can see the SQL type over here. And now we just can go back and we see, oh, our database is outdated. We have to update the database because of course we just changed the schema, but the actual database is still outdated. We can actually go over to the database exploration tool over here and click on the post table to see that the posts inside our database don't really have the created at column yet. So now we click on update DB in our app. Now we reload the page and we can see it's working again. When we now go to the database exploration tool again, click on post, we can see the created at column has been created. And now we can go to our post and of course we have to still display the timestamp. So we can just go and display it create at, and now it's displaying, but that's not really human friendly, so we can use a built-in time ago helper like this to display it in a more human readable format. Right now the posts are ordered in basically the way they are stored in the database. So we can actually just change it. Let's go to the post controller and inside the index action over here. We have this query posts, which is basically just fetching all the posts, and we can add the order by created at. Basically now it's the same order, right? But we want to have the oldest post first, basically. So we change it this way and now it already refreshed over here. We can just change it back just to see how fast this works. And now when we create a third post, it should be at the end of the list. Just fix this. Yeah, perfect. Oh, seems off. But basically, yeah, I think the timestamp got off from the first post and the second post, so don't worry about that. The next should be the first one actually. Let me create this one now. Yeah, it should be at the top. When we create a new one, it should be also at the top. So yeah, that's working. And now let's actually, when we create a new post, let's make the body a bit more beautiful, because right now it's just a simple text field, but let's make it a text area. So we can see this just works. We can also add a placeholder over here. And it just works. And let's add some help message over here. Type your title. And we can see it just works. So there's pretty cool stuff already built in. You just have to basically use it, and you can really quickly build new stuff in your application. And so in the next step, let's add something else to our application. Let's add some comments. So for that, we are going to go back to the schema designer and first have to add the data structure. So let's add our comments table first. And our comments table has an author, which is basically just a text field with your name in it. And we're going to have a body for the comment body. And of course, we are also going to have a post ID to reference the post. And yeah, you so basically, when we typed in post ID, it automatically set up a forged key constraint for our post table. So we can actually click on that forged key constraint over here and also change the on delete behavior of our forging key constraint, because we want our comments to be deleted when our post is deleted as well, right? So we just change this to cascade and update it. And yeah, so we can quickly take a look at the generated SQL code, which is basically backing that data structure. And we can see, yeah, it's basically just as expected. And over here at the last line, it basically just adds the constraints to the comments table, which references the post table with on delete set to cascade. And now we can generate a controller as well. We just right click, click on generate controller. We can again see a preview of all our files which are going to be generated. So when everything is fine, we can just click on generate. And the files have been generated. Actually, when you click over here, you can see like there's a comments folder and there's a comments controller over here and everything. So we can just go to our app and open slash comments. And again, we have to update the database, because of course the table is still not created yet. But when we hit update database, it's going to be created in the database. And now we see that there are still no comments yet. So let's add the first comment. We can see that we can type in basically everything, but we have to know our post ID. So let's first look up our post ID. Just take our last post over here. Then we just take the post ID, which is a UUID, by the way, and paste it in here to create our comment. And this already works. It's just a bit ugly right now. So let's first start by actually adding a link add comment over at our posts view. We can actually do this by going to our show posts, and then we add a new link to the new comment action. So it's already here. Now we click it, but of course this is still empty. So let's change this. We can do this by first actually changing the action type. We go to types and then we can see all the actions which our application has. It's basically each action is basically just, you can think of it as a message, and the actually executed code is just basically executing on the message you have received. So we have this new comment action, and we have to add a post ID parameter over here. And when we save this, this will show some errors, of course, which we have to fix. First, we have to update this one, the link to our new comment action, which also needs to have a post ID, of course. So we just pass this post ID over to the new comment action. So basically, we've defined this new comment action over here, right? And then it's a post ID field. So of course, we have to pass it as an argument to the data structure. And now we also have to update the comments index view, because you can see over here, there's still something in line 7. Sorry, somewhere here. Yeah, there's a new comment button over at the comments page. We can just remove it because we don't need it over there. And then we also have to update the controller, which is over here, because it also has to take in the post ID parameter. And when we now click add comment, you can see in the URL there's the post ID parameter passed, and but this one is still empty. So we now have to just set the post ID parameter to our comment, to this value we have given to from the action, basically. Something is off with the indentation. And now we can see this is filled into our form. So this is already pretty nice, but this is not really human readable. So let's just pass our post to the view. For that, we have to update the comments view over here. And basically, this is basically a list of arguments given to our view. Right now, it just takes a comment, which we are going to create. And we also need to pass a post now. So we had a post over here, and now it tells us, okay, we need to update the comments controller. So we have to basically fetch the post as well. We have the post ID given, right? So we can call fetch post ID, which will fetch the post. And then we also have to update it inside the create action, because the create action is also rendering the new view when there's a validation error. So we also have to fetch the post over here. We can just take it from the record over here. And now we can actually add the headline, for example, the title of the post over here, like this. So new comment for fourth post. This is already pretty nice, but of course we don't want to look at the post ID now, so we just make it a hidden field. Nice. And now let's also add some validation over here. We want our author field to be non-empty, and of course we also want our body to be non-empty. And now when we create post, it gives an error message. But let's also make this a text array field, the body. And yeah, so that's already pretty nice. We now use this. We can already create a post, and you can also see that the post ID is set to the, it should be this one. So post ID is set to the correct ID value, actually. So that's already pretty nice. So when we go back to the posts, we can just click add comment right now. And basically add our comment. But now when we add our comment, we are going to redirect it to this still ugly comments view. So it would be nice to be redirected back to the post we have commented on. So let's go to the comments controller and go to the create action, which we have here. We have this left case, which is basically executed when the validation has failed. There we have this right case, which is actually creating the record inside the database, which is also giving us this success message over here, this one. And here's the redirect tool, and it's just redirecting us to the comments action, but we want to go to the show post action. And now we have to pass the post ID, of course. Post ID, which we can just take from the comment because it's basically set on the comment, right? So now when we go back to the posts again and we click show add comment, if we click this, we are getting redirected back to our posts. And yeah, that's already pretty cool. But now let's make our post actually display our comments. For that, we have to go to the post controller. Into the post controller, and we have to click. We have to change the show function over here, the show post action. Right now, it's just fetching the post, but we have to also include the comments of that post. So we use fetch related. To tell it to also fetch all the comments belonging to this post. And now we are getting a type error because when we fetch the post of our comment, we also have to change our view because the type signature has changed because we are tracking the relationships at the type level to basically make sure that you actually have fetched the comments when you are rendering that view. So we have to go to the post show view, and we have to. So we don't just expect a post, but we expect a post comments. So we have to write include comments post, and now we can actually display so we can now actually display the comments of the post over here. Just representative. And we can actually see there's a list of comments over here already. And now we can basically render this over here. Now we can write a render comment function to render our comment. And we just render the name. We can just see the name has been rendered here. We can also, of course, add the comment body. And we can now see our comment being rendered here, which is pretty cool. But let's make this a bit more beautiful. Still don't like it. So let's also make this like this. Now it's a bit more beautiful. You can also bit padding over here. Yeah, nice. So yeah, this already works. Now when we click add comment, we can just add a comment here. You can see it over here. We can also add a timestamp to our comment as well. Let's quickly do that. We go back to our schema designer. We can see this. We click add a column. We enter create add again. Everything's automatically set. So we just click create column. Now we have to go back over here. We have to update the database again. And now the database is ready. We can display our timestamp, of course. Just add it over here. we again use time ago basically. Get created at from the comment time ago. Let's make it a bit, yeah, this nice. And of course now let's create a test post. Hello world, create post. Now we can add some comment. Just works, which is pretty nice. So I guess that's it already. So I hope you could basically take a short overview of IHP, and basically I hope you like it. And of course you can play around with it. So basically just take a look at the creating your first project section, to just do it one time and to get a feel for how to work with the tools. And when you are done, just take it and work with it and learn how to use it to make great stuff. And of course, you can find a lot of information inside the documentation. And at the end of this section, you can also find links to our GitHub repository, and you can subscribe to our newsletter, or you can, when you have some like weird Haskell type error, you can just join our GitHub chat and get some help. Of course, there's an IRC bridge available. And yeah, otherwise, let us know about your feedback. We are happy to hear, and have fun.